Hey, this is Mike with the One-Stop Co-op Shop, and it is time for some narrative adventure with Lands of Galzir, which is coming to GameFound very soon, maybe by the time this video airs. This one is by Sammy Lasko, who designed Dale of Merchants and Dawn of Peacemakers, both of which we've covered on the channel before. You can play it solo, you can play it 2-4 player competitive, or 2-4 player co-op. I'll be talking about solo and co-op play, of course, but honestly, it doesn't change much for competitive. It's a pretty straightforward game. Now, keep in mind, of course, everything you see is a prototype and is likely to change. They're still finishing up the story and such. And also remember that we never take payment for our Kickstarter or GameFound coverage. We just want to help you make an informed decision about the games you purchase. And I'm going to do my normal thing for previews. I'm going to do a full solo playthrough, and then at the end, I'm going to talk about my impressions of the game. So use the timestamps or chapters to skip right to that if you want to hear my thoughts and have fewer spoilers, because many of the little stories you see might be in the game. So feel free to watch a few and then skip to the end if you like. And if you enjoy the content on the One-Stop Co-op Shop, don't forget we also have a streaming channel. We have a Discord you can come and talk to us on. We also have a weekly podcast, and if you'd like to support us and get early access to our videos, check out our Patreon page. So the basic rules of Lands of Galzir are super simple. Each player is going to have a different character. I'm playing Aisala here, this bird, Kingfisher, and they're going to have a gold value. You start with 10, and then some spots around this little circle here are going to be marked off with these little pegs. Here I've got 2 on the eyeball kind of observation, 1 on the sort of like agility and sneakiness skill, and 1 on the yellow survival skill. These 6 icons represent the 6 skill types that might be called for in tests you attempt. And basically these pegs give you bonuses for the indicated skill and the one adjacent. So like my observation would also help me in acting or persuading people, and also I would be very good at the sort of theft and stealing skills. Now characters will also get these status effects. For each character, they have an inherent one to themselves that they can use once per play session, because this game is meant to be an ongoing campaign game. So I have Soar in the Sky, which lets me move a ton as long as I don't have any companions I want to bring along once per game. And I also start out with my own personal quest, A Friend in Need. We'll be getting into that storyline in a second. And cards like this will have a 4-digit code. The cards themselves have a 3-digit code. And what is this for? It's for the da-da-da-da Book of Adventures, which is on a website right now. I'm not sure if it'll be an app eventually. Start a new game, and we are in January. And you'll see on the left side here are all the different numbers of encounters you can sweep. It's randomly determined that we're going to start our adventure on Wednesday. We'll see what that means in a moment. And all the things that you might do come from this little book of adventures. So it kind of controls your encounters and things. Now, to show you a few other cards, we have January. This was randomly determined when I set up the campaign, which means we use the winter side of the game board. You'll see that in a moment. At the end of this session, which counts as 1 month of play, we'll move into February. Then March, and things will kind of evolve and change in the story, which is pretty cool. And then additionally, we've got the Harmony card, which you use for solo and co-op play. Basically, the difference between Harmony and Discord, the competitive card. In Discord, it's a race for each of the players to get the most prestige, kind of the victory points in the game, whereas Harmony has a set number of rounds based on player count, and you're all trying to collectively get as much prestige for kind of your group by the end of those rounds. And how do you mark that? Well, you put a little token on the X here. And then you've got your little day tracker here. I mentioned that we started on Wednesday. And in the case of solo, they've changed it to be 8 days for one session. So 2, 4, 6, 8. This will remind us after 8 rounds of the game, we will be done. So this will be a pretty quick playthrough. And it's going to be a lot of me reading narrative. So I hope you're ready for it. Now, in terms of the actual mechanics of a round, and here's the beautiful board I mentioned, the winter side, you'll have your little meeple. And let's say right now I'm in these forests. You can move up to 2 spaces. So like 1, 2, and you'll see these towns on the board that are represented by cards. Why cards? Because the board can shift based on the choices and adventures you have. So towns count as 1 space, even if they're represented by 2 or 3 cards, like this town up here. So for my 2 movement, I could like go there, or I could stop on the town. And then like a lot of these adventure games, after you move, you have an encounter. So if you're on a town, you can have the listed encounter that's there. I could visit the ranger station. If you have a quest and you're in the correct location, which doesn't really apply here, you can do the quest. And if none of those apply and you're just kind of in random wilderness, you flip the top event card and you resolve the first one that applies. Like if it was Tuesday, I would have a special unique encounter, but instead I would just do a more generic forest one here. And generally speaking, encounters will give you choices, and often they'll have a skill check. Like this one says a medium survival check. And if you click on that, it says reveal outcomes. And here's how tests work. You always have these five black dice, which have one of each icon on them, and you're looking for a matching icon. So that was a survival test, a little camp symbol. So here, blah, 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 total failure. I would get zero successes, and I would put that into the app and see what happened. But if you have pegs that match the skill or are adjacent, you can replace on a one-for-one basis that many of the black dice with the matching color die. So here, for example, for survival, I could put in my yellow for one of the black dice. And they have two faces that match the adjacent symbols, so books and swords are more likely. Books and swords being right next to it. Sorry, it's spinning. And you get, two double faces for the icon itself, in this case, survival. So my chances would be a little bit better. Boom, a double. So I would have two successes instead of zero. And you'll see in the playthrough, you quickly find inventory items and allies and skills. It can give you bonuses to certain types of tests. Or if you like discard the card, you can get extra successes. So there are lots of ways to kind of mitigate and improve your chances in tests as the game goes along. And just to show you what it looks like before we jump in, you just click on reveal outcomes and it'll say, oh, 0 to 1 successes do this, 2 to 3, 4 plus, and you click on the appropriate one and you find out what happens to you. Well, let's jump into our actual adventure and see what's up with Aisala. So first, let's meet our brave heroine. Aisala is a resourceful kingfisher whose abilities and keen instincts led her into and out of quite some trouble in the streets of her hometown. Growing up an orphan, she learned to rely on and trust only herself. That is, until a stranger showed her a way out and offered a new start in Galzir. And for each character, the first time you use them in a campaign, you do not put them on the board at all. Instead, they actually start on their little starting quest card, so they don't move at all the first round. They just automatically go into the starting your adventure encounter. This one says, a friend in need. With the help of a friend, you've come to Galzir for a fresh start. It is time to leave your old life behind and experience the adventures you've always yearned for. Start your adventure 0086. Standing at the top of the plank leading ashore, you view the busy docks below. Folks carrying cargo, negotiating passage, or just loitering, shouting, laughing, living their lives. You want to step down and join them, but this short, symbolic step from the ship means so much more. It means starting your life anew, leaving your troubled past behind, the past your new friend so kindly pulled you from. She should be waiting for you by the tavern, supposedly the worst Rhenishtum has to offer. Will you move already? The captain shouts behind you. Or do you want to go back or something? Well, let's step ashore and go meet our friend. And I haven't done this character yet, so I don't know what's going to happen. Walking through the seaside street, your mind wanders back to your benefactor. You met in awkward circumstances, yourself trying to steal from her. You could have ended up in jail again, or worse. But instead, she listened, showed compassion, and helped you out of some serious trouble. You don't fully understand how she did it or why. It took you a while to be able to trust her. You spot the tavern, the brewing toad, and your friend awaiting you. She's wearing a hood, but you can't mistake that beak. Her eyes light up as she finally sees you, and she greets you warmly. Here, I brought you something. Welcome to Galzir, Aisala. All right, so we're going to Rhenishtum. We're going to get a random 150. That's like a set of items, so I'll randomly get one. And 281, I think that'll be the next step of our quest. So Rhenishtum is the biggest town in the entire map. Oh, I'm so intimidated. Hello. You got a wishing well, docks, a market, an arena. That's fun. And the little handshake symbol means that you could do that as a group test. So even in competitive, you could do that, but usually that'll be co-op. If both of you are in Rhenishtum, when one of you has your encounter, you can go to the arena and help each other out. And that happens with a lot of tests. That's one of the main ways the game offers cooperation, in addition to being able to trade items and allies and money between each other. And a convention center and a casino. It has everything. And let's see, what 150 item did I get? A book, The Way of Spies. It's a book within a book. That's hilarious. So first, this bag icon shows this is an inventory item. You can only have 3 at a time, otherwise you have to ditch some. It has a gold value of 5 if I go to a market and have a chance to sell or buy stuff. It has the perception and literature tags. Many tests will say, do you have this tag or do you have that tag? And often if you have the tag, you can like skip the test entirely or have a big bonus. Let's see, a book studying the art of observing the unseen and searching the vanished. Famous for being as hard to find as it is cryptic to interpret. So in observation skill checks, you may reroll up to 1 die and convert 1 book into a success. That is pretty cool. So here we go. We'll store that here. So I'm even better at eyesight tests now. Oh, and here's Nara, my ally. Hello. She is a Eurasian hoopoe. Of course, the famous Eurasian hoopoe. I love that bird. I don't even know if that's real. So she's a roamer. She has the flight stat, which is good because my little soar in the sky ability lets me get +4 movement for a round. But if any of my companions don't have flight, I just leave them behind. She gives me an automatic star and automatic success in survival tests, and in sneak and intimidate tests, if those verbs appear in the text of the test, I can reroll up to 2 dice. But she's only gonna hang out with me for 5 rounds, and then I guess she has other stuff to do, so I will not have her forever. Your allies tend to come and go while they kind of do their own thing. And once again, to show you that timing mechanic, I put a token here, and I put a matching token 5 days ahead. So when I reach there, she will leave. You have your wits, but to make it here, you'll need more than that. Nara blabbers on as the two of you tour the city's market. She blabbers? I'm so mean to my friends. Wouldn't hurt to try to make a good impression or to pick up a book every once in a while. You do know how to read, right? Most importantly, be careful out there. Why is she throwing some shade at me? She just gave me a book. Of course I know how to read. You notice her grimace briefly at the last bit, but before you can ask her about it, she excuses herself to visit one of the stalls nearby, which seems to offer camping equipment. Left alone for a moment, you look around the busy market, curious about this foreign city you've ended up in. What are these folks like? So, choices, I can observe the folk at the market, which is a medium difficulty observation test, but observation, my best skill. Or I can recall what I know about the city. Well, let's observe, right? So it says reveal outcomes, but first I'm gonna roll the dice. And I can use bonuses and items and stuff after I roll the dice. So I'm gonna get rid of 3 black dice. I get both of my purple eyeball dice and my little agility stealth die, because again, it's adjacent, so it has a better chance of rolling the eyeball. And I'm also gonna use my yellow die. Why? Because it is a 1/3 chance of rolling a book. And let's not forget, in eyeball skill checks, I can convert 1 book into a star. So I take the 1/6 chance the black die would have given me, and I turn it into a 1/3 chance. All right, show me some eyeballs. That seemed pretty ridiculous. Okay, so let's see. I've got 4, I've got 5 in eyeball checks for my Way of Spies. I can reroll 1 die. Oh my gosh, that is 6 successes. I am observing like, whoa. Reveal those outcomes. 4 plus, yes, 6 definitely counts. The market is certainly busy. There's more folks in one place than you've ever seen before. But you don't let that faze you and calmly study the colorful crowd. Almost immediately, your sharp eyes spot something disconcerting. A group of vultures just entered the marketplace, and they definitely don't look like they're here to do shopping. You observe the vultures briefly as they wade through the crowds, clearly looking for someone. I wonder if this is my friend. You also catch glimpses of the weapons they're carrying. Every instinct you've honed over the years tells you that they're bad news and should be avoided. You interrupt Nara's haggling, and after a bit of trying, manage to point out the still distant vultures to her. Looks like the ones who tried to catch me once already, she says, squinting her eyes. I'm afraid they're after you too. Dang it! What'd you do to me, Nara? You watch for a moment as they question the folks in the market, one of which points your way, you jerk. We should get out of here, Aisala. All right, so will we sneak away through the crowd or convince the folks around you to help you? All right, well, I'm definitely better at sneaking, and it's an easy one, so let's do that. So since eyeballs are adjacent to that, I am still going to use all of those, but the Way of Spies only helps with eyeball skill checks, so I'm not going to use that yellow die. And oof, okay, that's only 1. That's only 1. I don't have any rerolls or anything. But it was an easy skill check. Come on, is 1 enough? Do we sneak? Yes, 1 to 2. We get the middle result. You dive into the crowd and do your best to avoid the vulture's eyes as you escape the market. They catch sight of you once or twice, but cannot keep up, and eventually you manage to lose them completely. There's some upstart group, Nara whispers to you at a safe distance while you watch the vultures frantically search for you. You can probably guess why they're after us. I can't at all. Oh, you can indeed. Never mind. Yes, I can. Looks like you weren't quite done with your past just yet. You'd have to deal with that before you can begin your new life in earnest. So we gain 2 prestige, which, remember, is kind of our main victory goal. Although, really, it's just about having a good adventure. Like, it's not like you lose the game if you don't get enough. We're going to return the first quest and gain 268, which I'm sure will be the next step of this quest. And that is the end of the scene, the end of the round. It's as quick as that. I'm going to show you the prestige. We are famous. And then sort of 7th continent style, they've got dividers for the cards. This is just a subset of what will be in the actual game, but we'll grab that new quest. Here we go. Some upstarts tried to catch you. You need to find a way to deal with them and any future pursuers. According to Nara, there's a group in Tashun who might be able to help you. She said she will meet you there if you get separated. So if we're in Tashun at any point, we can have as our encounter Seek Aid, which is a cooperative one if we want it to be. And that would be 0090, so we gotta get there. Well, there's more to do than just your character's specific quests. You get just the back, kind of the basics of 3 other quests at a time, which is like the quest board. And they tell you which city you have to go to start them. So there are 2 available in Arheen and 1 in Chabar, none of them where we are. But let's see, let's get our bearings a bit. So Arheen with 2 quests is down here in the corner. Chabar is way up at the top. You probably can't even see it with the angle. And Dishoon is actually very close to the east. Just, let's see, one, two rounds of movement would get us there for the next step of our story. So I think we'll do that instead of going down to Arheen. Well, like I said, a whole round is just moving and having an encounter. So we did that. So we advance to Thursday and we would now resolve any tokens we had reached. And then we go into a new round. So I'm gonna have an adventure, two spaces. And because I am nowhere special, I just flip this over. And again, we do the first one that applies. Am I wounded? No, I'm not, but I'm in a grassland. 0216. That's right, y'all. The entire game is basically rolling and reading. Be ready. The wind has been rising and falling all day as you travel across an open grassland. Ahead is a weed-riddled bubbling brook, or babbling, bubbling and babbling. A stone bridge reaches over the short width of stream in the direction you are heading to. Trolls? I don't know. Oh, a family of ducks is halted at the mouth of the bridge. Did you hear that? The husband asks after spotting you, his voice an emasculated squeak. Did you hear that? Before you can answer, you hear it. A curdled gargle builds up to a long, shrill shriek coming from under the bridge. It must be a monster, the father cries. We have a boat to catch. We cannot suffer any more delays, the wife protests. There's no such thing as monsters, but what else could possibly make such a noise? Do we have the champion tag? No, we do not. So let's see. We can try to convince the ducks it's safe, medium persuasion, or observe the bridge and the sounds. Ooh, that is our best skill, but it's hard. Or find another route. We're going to observe. All right, we already know the drill for this skill test. Okay. Ooh, that's three. And I can reroll one. Definitely the purple, because that is the chance of a double. Five. And just to remind you, I'm rerolling because of this. It says in those type of skill check, I can reroll one die. That sound cannot hide from me. Yes, best result. Observing the area, you pinpoint the source of the noise. The thin cry of the creature is just the wind passing through the wet weeds. Oh, you emasculated husband, you. And breaking against the jagged underside of the bridge, you tell the family as such and ask them to pay attention the next time the wind picks up. As you predicted, the noise is heard next when the wind grows stronger. After waiting and listening, the father and his ducklings realize you are right and breathe a sigh of relief. The mother gives a pleased smile. Traveling with a calm family makes my life much, much easier. Here, take this. She gives you some gold and an item for helping you out as you all cross over the bridge. All I did was find the wind, lady, but thank you. So one prestige, one money, card 14, or you get a random item if the specific item's not available, and this event goes to the bottom of the deck. So gold's just a spinner 11. And heck yes, the wife gave me her drums. Of course she did. While cumbersome to haul around, drumming can prove instrumental, ha ha ha, in surprising many situations. Pangolins in particular enjoy the novelty of a momentary rhythm in their lives. So I now have the music tag, an explore and intimidate test. I can reroll a die up to two times. You may choose a different die each time. And on recall tests, I can reroll one. So I can play some music to help me remember something. I love it. My fame grows. I evaded the evil birds and I saved the family. I don't know, my buddy is gonna leave soon. It's Friday. All right, so let's go into Tashoon. Only one card, and it has ruins and an armed camp, so clearly not the nicest place. I could choose to do one of those, but let's seek some aid to help escape these people pursuing us. 0090. Violet Arms mercenary camp lies deep within the ruined town, and as you approach the guard post, you eye the imposing wall that still stands on this side. Flying over would have been tough with all the gear you're carrying, but luckily you don't have to. They are not your enemies. In fact, you're here to ask for their help. And it asks, do I have a roamer tag? And I don't, but Nara does. Thank you so much. So yes. At Nara's behest, you approach the two guards and ask to see their leader. They laugh.
The boss is busy, one says. What's a squirt like you want with him?
Squirt, how dare you?
How about you show us what you can do first? The other interjects, pointing at the wall surrounding the camp. Climb that and we'll take you to him.
You glance at Nara, but she simply shrugs, signaling she'll go along with whatever you decide. I mean, can I just fly over? I guess that wouldn't really pass their test. So, climb over the wall is hard, but Nara gives me an automatic success on yellow tests. Ooh, but intimidate the guards? You know what can be super duper intimidating? Kala knows this. Friggin' drums! Yes, I get two rerolls if I use the drums in the intimidation test. Let's do it. So that's a medium like acting and persuasion test, which means my eyeballs will help. So we'll go with this, and we've got our drums to help after we're done. So I got one success, and we can reroll the same die twice. That's not it. Come on, come on. Give me a second one. No! One might not be enough. Come on, I'm very scary. Be intimidated, be intimidated. No! Worst result. You try to threaten them with intense pot of berets, but they just laugh.
All bark, but no bite, one says. I guess the boss was wrong this time. He motions toward one of the larger tents. Go on, then. He wants to see you.
Go ahead, Nara says. I'll talk to these two.
All right, well, I guess I would have probably gotten some prestige and some rewards, but I'll still get to talk.
Inside is a lone falcon. This is a very bird-centric adventure. My last one didn't have any birds at all. He introduces himself as Geru.
I heard about Rienstum, he says, but don't worry. Those thugs have caused trouble for us as well, so we'll take care of them.
You ask how he knows about that, but he just smirks.
I like to stay informed, Aizala.
Oh, he knows my name.
Now, was there anything else? You insist to take part, which seems to humor him somewhat.
The two of us are birds of a feather.
Very well. We've intercepted some of their equipment, including this coded letter. Show me what you can do. So once again, I think I'm going to go with eyeballs. It's kind of my specialty.
My drum won't help me this time, but come on, way of the spies. Oh, okay. So that's two, and then I get one reroll. Come on, give me that double.
Yeah, four. Oh, and my book gets converted. Five.
Whoa. Searching that equipment like a boss. Four plus. Get it.
Quickly and efficiently, you investigate the pile by the side of the tent. There's mostly clothing and supplies, clearly meant for a long-term mission. However, you also find a hidden pocket which has a familiar-looking blue face paint.
Interesting, Guru says, raising up. Follow me.
Blue face paint. Man, there's like all this background I'm not aware of. As you step outside, however, a mercenary runs you, showing there's been a fight at the guard post. Guru curses and motions you to follow while he rushes toward the post where you just were. There, you see a wounded guard lying on the ground, and Nara is nowhere to be seen! No!
Boss, he shouts, she was with the vultures. I tried to stop her, but she captured Nara.
Garrett turns to you with a grim look on his face.
They have crossed us once more, Aizala, and we'll make them pay. No!
No, she goes back to the library. She's gone, my friend!
Do I have a mercenary tag? No, I don't.
Take one of ours and meet me in Hazembi. They have a base there, and I suspect that's where they're taking Nara. We'll crush them together. Yes, one prestige. Okay, we're going to get a new quest, and we gain a random 149 item. Oh, and we delay our new companion by two. I'll show you what that means in a second. So they lent me a mercenary buddy, Marlena the Brown Bear. Due to her skills and attitude, protecting vital targets usually falls on Marlena. So she has Sentinel, she has Mercenary. In fight and force test, automatically two successes? Heck yes. And she'll leave after three rounds, but it says when that happens, you can spend three money to delay two, give you two more rounds with her. Basically, you can pay her to keep her around. But remember, the app said that we delay two for free, so she's going to be with us for five turns, which is almost until the end of the entire session. Yes. And here's part three of our quest. Your friend was captured and taken to his MB. Thankfully, you managed to get the Violet Arm mercenaries to help you. While they cause a distraction, you'll get inside the base and put an end to this. So we have to enter the base in his MB. And let's not forget, we're at through four prestige now, all right. Oh, nice, Zembi is a quick skip away. It is three spaces, so it will take me two rounds. I could soar in the sky to get there straight away, but since my bear can't fly, he would be left behind. So I think I'll just go the long way. All right, it's Saturday, the best day. I'm on the road to Zembi. Okay, so I'm in the hills at a port. Random event time. Am I exhausted? No, so I'm at the hills, 0245. Traveling up the rising and falling hillside road, you hear shouting in the distance, and not long after arrive at its source. Shrinking back, a jackal merchant is trying to calm down a massive emu. Why is it always birds?
I apologize if the drink was not to your liking, but I cannot give you a refund.
The breath nearly catches in your throat when you see the customer dip to his knees, grab hold of the underside of the jackal's cart, and flip it over. Emus are dangerous, sending it tumbling down the hill and crashing at the bottom. The merchant screams when she sees all of her drums of beverages smashed apart on the rocks, spilling her liquid cargo. The emu grabs hold of the jackal.
I want my money back, he thunders.
Do I have the serene tag? No, I do not, and I don't think you do either, emu. You seem a little bit upset. All right, so should we convince the emu to calm down? Subdue the angry emu? Ah, it's subdue and not fight or force, so my bear can't help me. We're not trying to kill the emu. Or ignore it and continue on.
Well, my heart says I'd rather convince, but subdue is easier, so I guess I'm gonna do that one.
And even though I have no sword training specifically, both of the adjacent ones will help me, so I'll swap out those dice. I'm looking for swords, not super optimistic. Oh, or maybe, actually that was pretty good. Yeah, two, all right. I think I'm just gonna have Marlena sit on the emu. Okay, I got the middle result. Charging in to save the jackal, you have a brief and violent clash. The emu relies on pure rage to fight with, but it makes him clumsy and not that difficult to overcome. Amazed, the jackal looks between you and the downed brute.
Well, thank you.
Sneering down at the dazed emu, she sticks her tongue out.
See, not very pleasant being on the receiving end, is it?
The emu passes out. Whoops, sorry, buddy. Ignoring him, the jackal gives you a deep and humble bow.
Thank you for coming to my rescue.
She looks down to her overturned wagon. Now just get that back on the road.
If you were less tired from the fight, you would help her, but you have more traveling ahead of you. So I just gained one prestige, and that's it, but I'll take it. And I'll be honest, this is better than I usually do. I am rocking it.
We're on to Sunday.
And moving to Hazembi. They've got docks, mines, market, theater, and I'm going to ignore all of that and go into the base. Approaching the designated meeting spot, you see the Violet Arm mercenaries already in position, ready to storm the Vulture Gang's base. You feel like running away, do I? Like you've done so many times, but no! In those times, nothing good would have come from staying. There was nothing on the line. You see Garu as well, observing the sizable building in the distance and the several guards posted at front. You approach him and ask if he has any other instructions.
Go in and do things your way, he says, smiling wickedly. That's what you adventurers do, right?
Yeah, that does sound about right.
We'll move on your mark, Isala, he adds before turning away.
Is he still testing you?
All right.
Unlock the side door, fight our way in. Unlocking would be a bit better dice-wise, but fight would give us an automatic 2 for Marlena the Bear, so I'm gonna fight. These people hurt my friend! I say, oh no, you give me a sword? Okay, 1 sword, so 3 with my bear friend. Thank God she's there. But is 3 enough? Ooh, it is, I got exactly in the middle. You sound the horn and attack the base, the mercenaries following right behind you. At the face of your terrifying charge, some of the guards flee outright while others try to desperately call for reinforcements, but you have no time for that. Like a spear of vengeance, you push right through their defenses and rush inside. Your cohorts can handle the rest out here. By the way, if you're not hearing some epic battle music, I have failed entirely in my editing. You rush inside the base, and right away you see Nara tied up, beak and all, but otherwise okay. Before you can move to her, however, the vulture who is guarding her notices you, heaves Nara over his shoulder, and runs out the back door toward the city. Okay, I gotta run after them or follow them from a distance. Yeah, we're gonna be sneaky, because that's what we're good at. Boosh. All right, so our good old way of spies fallback. Come on. Oh, man. Wait, what was I looking for? Yes, that. And that's fine because of the skill, so let's use my reroll from Way of Spies for that. Yes! That is 4. Follow him. Yo, that was way easier than I thought. You do what you do best and err on the side of caution, keeping a careful eye on the vulture while you follow him through the outskirts of the town. You watch him closely, looking for an opportunity, and when he lowers Nara for just a moment to look around, you swoop in and release her from her bonds. Yes! You pull Nara up, and she thanks you briefly before you turn to face the suddenly cornered vulture together.
I surrender, he says, rising his wings up while darting his eyes between you.
I guess I'll tie him up. You don't need to resort to petty vengeance. You've already won. You simply tie him up and start escorting him back to the base.
Nicely done, Garu says as you arrive, and he gives you a nod before returning to overseeing the cleanup.
A nod, that's it, buddy, come on.
He's right, Nara says, and gives you a warm hug. You did very well, like a great adventurer would. She winks at you.
But I'd still like to watch over you for a while. What do you say?
Suits you just fine. All right, so I gain 2 prestige. I get 290.
Oh, this fun. Look, it's Nara with her hood down. She trusts me more, I guess. Being something of a professional problem solver, although not always a successful one, has left Nara with a wealth of connections and experience.
And it's interesting, now instead of being sneaky and intimidating, she observes and convinces. She's staying with me for 5, which will take me through to the end of a scenario. That means I also still have Marlena. I am ready with friends all over.
Yeah, look at this, 7 prestige.
But we're just about at the end of the session. It's Monday, and we'll still have Tuesday and then Wednesday, and that is it. So 3 more rounds. So let's see, I guess I might as well do something in Hazembi. Do I want to go to the market, go to the theater, go to the mines, go to the docks?
The mine sounds exciting. A mine, 0014.
Arriving at the mines, you are greeted by the massive pit head reaching to the sky, the scramble of office buildings around it, and curiously, a noisy congregation of dirty-faced workers. Why is that curious? Getting closer, you gather they are protesting their pay, working conditions and the quality of their equipment, at least based on the slogans they occasionally shout.
So wait, if I look for work, I'll be like a scab, right?
Like breaking the work lines, so I guess I'll mingle with them. The miners prove to be a jolly bunch despite their cold, darkened faces. Among hearty introductions and the occasional shouted slogan, they take the time to tell you about their struggle. Apparently, they've tolerated their poor working conditions for a long time, but things have only gotten worse. Some time ago, a mongoose by the name of Permitivo, oh, that mongoose, came by and inspired them, oh, he's a good guy, to strike while the iron is hot, the mines recently being more profitable than ever. Fighting for their rights is a lengthy process, however, and just standing around gets boring after a while.
Hey, adventurer, one of them shouts. Any ideas how we could pass the time?
I could recall the history of the mine. I could spend 2 money on an arm wrestling competition. Or I could climb the pit head competition for 2 money. Well, let's see. Nara would give me an automatic success in the climb the pit head, but I wouldn't have a ton of skill bonuses. I think recall the history. Well, that's not really good for me either, is it?
So yeah, now let's go for the competition. Spend two money. So since it's a survival attempt check, I get one success for free from Nara. That's the only bonus, and just the yellow will apply. Not great. I should have Marlena play the drums to encourage me on or something, but... ooh, yes! So that is three successes. Not enough to get the best result, but maybe I'll come in, like, second place. After a few moments of looking back and forth between you and the towering structure, the miners agree to your idea and you get a race going. It's a tough climb, and you can barely pull ahead most of the competitors. One Makake, oh my gosh, I'm sorry, but somebody can tell me how to pronounce that, is too quick for you, however, and narrowly beats you to the top. Getting back down, the miners congratulate you for the daring idea and pay you your share for coming in second. As they return to picketing, however, a sleepy-looking bat pulls you aside. A friend of mine could use those skills and attitude of yours, he says. He discreetly hands you something and gives a sly wink before returning to the others. Yes, 6 gold, and I get a card 99. So up to 15 out of a max of 20. And oh cool, it's a random special quest, Herbal Recovery. Herbal tea is one of the most luxurious products we make at Alluring Shrubs and Herbs. It's my job to cultivate and take care of the drying process of the leaves. I've detected lost packages in bookkeeping with patients. I tracked down their likely location. Gemelec, the rough-tailed gecko horticulturalist. So I need to go to Yezdin to meet Gemelec. And if I abandon it, give up the quest, then I place it into the vault. So this is like a very special quest. No one else will be able to get this otherwise. But yeah, guess where Yezdin is? This is the farthest away city from where I am right now in the other corner of the map. But I've got an idea for that. I've got an idea because it is going to Tuesday and we're going to lose Marlena tomorrow. So why not use my once per game Soar in the Sky to go +4 and I'll just leave Marlena behind. She can leave a little bit early. Oh gosh, I think it's so far I'm still not going to make it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So next turn I can make it into Chabar where there is a quest so I can at least take that up and then I'll be close to Yezdem but won't make it this game. Now let's see my event. I'm in the mountains. It's not Saturday, so 0209. Hiking along a mountain road, tiny pebbles and dust slide from the higher peaks around you as the ground shivers with a distant groan. Should you pay it no heed? That sounds stupid. Keep going or take a moment and reflect on your surroundings. Okay, so if I recall, each explorer tag gives you 1 star. I don't have any of those. So I could recall, and my drum would give me +1. It seems like playing a drum while thinking about earthquakes is maybe not the best idea. Or I can observe. Yep, we're doing that. And it's our same old with the Way of Spies. Oh my gosh. And let's see, I get a reroll. Which one is the best? I guess this one. Trying to get the book, which I can change to a success. So that's 2, 3, 5, 6. I am just super observant. 5+, yes. Your sharp eyes grope the hilltops. What? My eyes grope the hilltops? I hope they change that verb later. And you spot a small slide of pebbles and stones coming from under a huge boulder, shadowing the road behind you. It's in the perfect position that if it fell, it would squash the lemur caravan behind you. Where'd they come from? You run to them, call out a warning while pointing at the boulder. With this swift, vigilant alert, the lemurs get themselves and their carts far away from the boulder before moments later it topples over the edge and crashes into the road. Cheering you on as their hero, the lemurs give you an item from their caravan as thanks for warning them about the falling rock. Yes, 1 prestige, and I get card 16. Oh, and then I get card 156 and place the card, huh? We'll see what that is in a second. Let's see what 16 is. Well, this will be my third item along with my book and my drums. Climbing axes. It gives me the pick and weapon tags. Ooh, when climbing, I get an automatic success and can reroll a die. And when fighting and forcing, I can change 1 survival into a star. That's nice since I have a survival special die. And that was pretty heroic. I think I deserve that prestige. Oh, and very cool. I told you that the map can change. So the aftershocks from the earthquake have affected one of the towns. So it'll cover up one of the cards or at least be like with the cards. And it gives me a new adventure there to visit the ruins from the earthquake having destroyed several buildings if I get there within 5 rounds. Which city is it for? Chabar. Isn't that where I'm going? Yes. So bloop. There it is. I'll be there next turn and I'll check that out. Very cool. Because this is indeed going to be my last round. So let's move on in there. Before we go to the ruins, at any point during your turn, if you are on the same space as another character, you can trade items and money with them, but you can also get quests. So let's see, an inquisitive but an inconspicuous person needed. Contact the sawmill headquarters for more information. And you get to flip it when you actually take it. Smoldering Wood, Part 1. Rovun, my employer, owns a large sawmill. A lynx named Halemo is currently in prison for an attempt at burning it down. We believe Jonka, there's a lot of names, a previous co-owner of the saw, to be behind the arson plan. Please find evidence to support our presumptions. Jonka's firm is the logical place to start. So if we go to the town of Yezdin, which is where we're going anyway, we can visit Jonka's firm and have this adventure. Very cool.
And whenever you take a quest, a new one goes to the board, so we have one in Teshun now. But for the last thing we'll do this game, let's visit these ruins, since it's a special event. You stroll into the aftermath of the earthquake. All around you is the rubble from toppled buildings, soil and rock churned from land, and twisted, ragged bodies of those slaughtered by this force of nature. Oh no! Civilians and firefighters alike work to clear debris and hunt for survivors, all in tune to moans of many wounded who are being treated in a nearby white tent. Like columns of ants, wagons pull the wounded and dead to and from the treatment tent. This is not at all fun. A thorny devil fire chief is trying to coordinate rescue efforts with a lovebird physician and are calling on anyone in the area to help. Okay, so if we search, each hearing tag gives plus one. We don't have that. We're definitely going to search for survivors. Oh yeah, if we had our bear, forcing would be good for plus two stars, but let's search. All right, maybe our last skill test of the game, and it's not a great one. We can reroll one. Oh man, we are not helping at all after this earthquake. Oh, interesting. So you take the leftmost result that applies, and we definitely have a lot of hands, so we have to do this one. It strikes you, oh man, come on. There might be loot to be had in the rubble. You could take it and ditch this place. I don't wanna. Okay, we have the choice. Oh, I'm gonna continue searching. I don't wanna be a meanie. Yeah, use a result from the previous check. Okay, at least they give you the option. It'd be terrible if they forced you. From the screams, the sight, the smell, all of it is just too horrible for you to focus as you try to keep your lunch down, which you nearly fail at doing when you uncover a gruesomely twisted body. Having had all of this living nightmare that you can take, you wander off looking for fresh air. Oh, that was sad. All right, well, that's the end of my adventure. So we've reached the end of January. We're now going to go to 0200 for our final little encounter, which just kind of checks how we did, use our prestige, and see how our adventure went. But here's the thing. If I wanted to play into February, I would still have 15 money. I'd still have my 3 items. Now, Nara would go away. I'd have to find her again to have her adventure with me. But I'd also sell both my quests, so I could still go to Yezdin and investigate that arson and try to find those herbs. But for now, let's see how 8 prestige did for me. I think it's got to be a lot. After all the excitement, challenges, and adventure, it's time to unwind for a moment and reflect on your travels. Let's see, do I have an isolated tag? No? You head to the nearest inn, intent on treating yourself to a well-deserved evening, celebrating this leg of your journey. Already from the outside, you can hear the sounds of lively patrons, suggesting that the establishment is quite full once again. Despite the noise, all heads turn as you enter, curious to see the new arrival. So I can throw a party for 5 money or celebrate alone. I got 15 money. Let's throw the party. And how much prestige? Oh man, almost the highest. Everyone recognizes you as you strut into the bar. They cheer and marvel at seeing someone so famous. You buy a round of drinks for the patrons who all swarm around you in adoration. With a single command, you unleash a party that consumes the whole building. Party, everyone, I command it. You regale a captivated audience with tales of your most daring exploits through to the next day. Once the party's finally finished, the place is littered with stuff left behind from the party. You help the innkeeper clean up, who offers for you to take anything left over that you want. Okay, so this is something that happens often. You may swap one of your skill marks for any other skill mark. So I could now move one of these and get like 1 blue instead of 2 purple, or get sword instead of the hand kind of stealth thing. And that'll match up with your skills well. Like maybe I want to have a more survival tent skill to make my climbing axes more useful. For now, we won't worry about it since we're stopping here, but that's how that all works. So there you go. That was 1 month in the grand adventure of Aisala. So hang out if you want to hear my impressions on the game for solo and co-op play, especially so far. All right, so first of all, the app, the website works perfectly. And I like the fact that it's an app because you might have seen a few like little minor typos I had to kind of fix as I read. But Sammy, the designer, has said they're going to carefully log every typo that's found. Of course, they'll probably fix them all for the campaign in the first place. But even while people are playing, they can still go back and fix them, which with a physical book, they would not be able to. Now, I don't mind apps. And as someone who played a ton of choose your own adventure games in the past, I love just being able to click on a number and go there immediately instead of having to flip through the pages. But of course, the fact that you absolutely must have a device, they have said that they're not going to have any printed books. And I respect that. I don't really want to have more trees cut down for this kind of stuff. If you hate having a website or an app to deal with while you're playing a game, that might bother you. But for me, I think it's really good. And the big thing is, I think the adventures are fun. I think the writing is well done. I think the setting with the like animal characters is fascinating. I really enjoy being in this world. And since a lot of your time, as you saw, is going to be either hearing other players reading their tales or reading them to the other players or kind of experiencing it yourself, you're going to have to love this. I certainly do to enjoy this. But putting the narrative to the side for a second, how are the mechanics? And as you saw, they are incredibly straightforward. Like it takes 10 seconds to teach somebody how to play this game. Move up to 2, have an adventure, roll some dice. But I think it's still pretty fun, mainly because of the items and allies.
The fact that they push you toward certain kinds of tests and they give you like rerolls and free successes and abilities, it makes you feel cool. And usually you can kind of tell like the quest that will align with your skills. Like, don't take a warlike quest if you're not good at fighting. So I feel like you have some control, but again, you definitely have to enjoy the narrative ride because this is a very random kind of simplistic resolution system. And if you're here looking for like hand management or resource management or high strategy, you're not going to find it even in the slightest. One of the other things I really like is the ongoing world. I've only seen a little glimpse of this, but there are cards, without spoilers, that like change out the cards on the cities, so different things are available. And there's kind of like these ongoing quests that change some of the things in the world. You saw that I found Nara, and now she would be unlocked as a potential ally that could help us in the future. So I think it is very cool when you can add players in and drop them out without any trouble. Now, for positive and negative, I would compare this to Sleeping Gods, where it's really mostly kind of like a bunch of side quests. It's not like you have one way to win the game. And even more so than Sleeping Gods, because that one, at least after you went through like the three sessions or the three event decks, would have like a final ending for your play. But this one, to my understanding, you can just kind of play forever, you know, and like keep on exploring around and seeing things. That'll appeal to some players, that will not appeal to others. I think for my family and for like solo play, that could be a lot of fun. And then I could like mix up which characters I'm using and change things up. But if you're looking for like a cohesive narrative that only has one thing going on, and you're just like kind of along for the adventure and you want a clear ending, this isn't really going to provide that. So again, it might be something to be cautious about based on your preferences. And one last thing to mention in terms of co-op, you saw that there are tests you can do together. You can trade items to people. Like if this item works better for somebody else, you can pass it along. But sometimes you'll just kind of go off in your direction and I'll go off in mine. Like I have to go to Rangestum and you have to go over to like the other corner of the map and you won't be able to aid each other. So sometimes it'll feel like you're kind of doing your own thing and just building up prestige together. So I think a lot of enjoyment for co-op of this one is going to depend on whether you enjoy hearing the stories of other players. If you're playing two player, you'll take turns reading to each other, so you'll always be active. But with three or four players, you definitely need to enjoy hearing the adventures of others read aloud and that kind of stuff, because you're not going to be necessarily engaging with each other all of the time. So that was Lands of Galzir. I hope you enjoyed the playthrough and my reading and adventures. And go check out the GameFound page when it's live to see what you think for yourself. Good gaming, and I'll see you at the next stop.